Okay, thank you. Welcome to the fifth meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies today. Agenda item 1 is to agree whether to take items 3 and 4 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence and our approach to longer-term development work on pre-budget scrutiny. Are we all agreed? Okay, that is agreed. Thank you. Next agenda item is to begin our evidence taking on pre-budget scrutiny. We'll hear from two panels of witnesses today. So I welcome our first panel of witnesses, Dr. Alison Hosey, Research Officer, Scottish Human Rights Commission, SHRC, and Dr. Angela O'Hagan, Chair of the Equality Budget Advisory Group, EBAG, who both join us virtually. You're very welcome. And to Emma Congreve, Knowledge Exchange Fellow at the Fraser of Allender Institute, and Chris Burt, Associate Director for Scotland of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, who both join us in person today. You're all very welcome. So I thank witnesses, first of all, for your helpful written submissions, and I will invite each of you to make short opening statements, starting with Dr. Alison Hosey, please. Dr. Hosey.
Good morning. Thanks very much for the invitation to join you today. From the Commission's perspective, we just want to reiterate that the resources are absolutely critical to ensuring that the funding for policies, plans and programmes that the government needs to set out and need to protect our rights from the impacts of the pandemic now and to build a fairer and more resilient economy as we move forward. And the government has an obligation to maximise its available resources to guarantee these rights. And that means that how you raise, allocate and spend money, it must be done in a way that targets inequalities. And we've seen these amplified by the pandemic, and we need to tailor the responses to people's lived realities. And as a response to the pandemic, we've seen agreement for the need for a massive mobilisation of resources in order to protect people's health and to prevent huge economic devastation. And many countries, including the UK and Scotland, have been pretty radical on the spending side. But what we're still left with is the question of how we go about raising the necessary funds to pay for that recovery and to ensure that that's done fairly. And a lot of our submission, we looked at the issues of taxation as the most sustainable and effective and accountable way for governments to raise money. But we've seen a growing inequality of wealth over the last 40 years, and in part how and what we tax is the reason for that. We treat earned and unearned income differently. We tax wealth at very low rates compared to earned income, and allowing money to be hidden overseas, which has resulted in an unprecedented level of income or wealth inequality, wealth concentration and soaring inequality. So the pandemic has dramatically amplified the stark inequalities of all sorts. And so economic disadvantage has translated into a key underlying precondition for the worst impacts of COVID-19. We've seen the death rate for people on low wages be 3 times that of those on higher wages in the UK. And how governments now finance their COVID response has the ability to affect those inequalities. And we must ensure that the minimum levels of rights are enjoyed in that recovery process. So it's really encouraging to see the Scottish Government's current work on the Scottish taxation framework that's currently under review. And we would like to encourage more of an explicit recognition of the government's human rights obligations, maximise its available resources within that framework. We really welcome the focus of the committee in this particular session on from an explicit human rights perspective. The new forthcoming human rights legislation brings these obligations closer to home, but they are obligations that already exist. Embedding those obligations explicitly in the budget process will help successful implementation of this new legislation that will be forthcoming. So, as I say, we welcome the focus of the committee's questions, and we look forward to engaging further on this today and in the future. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We now hear from Dr. Angela O'Hagan.
Good morning, convener. Thank you very much to you and your colleagues for the invitation to come along this morning. I'd just like to echo Dr. Hosey's comments there in welcoming the committee's approach here, that you're taking and or embarking upon a human rights approach to budget scrutiny. It's very welcome and it's essential, as Ali has just set out. Within that, however, it is of course necessary to maintain an equalities focus. And some of your questions in the call for views reflect that understanding that policy decisions affect people differently. The structural inequalities that COVID has laid bare, COVID didn't create them, they were there before the pandemic hit, but COVID has massively exposed the trenchant inequalities in Scotland that have to be addressed. And I think my comments in my written contribution and probably my contribution this morning, I want to focus on the need for scrutiny from an equalities and human rights perspective. You've asked about the size of the pie, as it were, you know, the range of the extent of resource available. But it's about the efficiency and effectiveness of that spend, and that is improved when it is better directed. And it's better directed when there's an understanding of the status quo through generating and using good equalities data as a starting point to understand the status quo and moving on from there. And that means having equalities and human rights goals and ambitions as the starting point for remedial and progressive action that is transformational in terms of the outcomes. And so to do that, there needs to be effective and consistent scrutiny by not just this committee, but across the parliamentary committees. EBAG is working with officials across Scottish Government to try and improve the processes, building inequalities analysis, building competence, building the knowledge there. But as I said in my submission, some of the recommendations to improve the work within government also apply within Parliament in terms of building knowledge, building that confidence, and today's session embarking on a human rights approach to budget scrutiny is one of those very welcome steps. So thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you. And Emma Congreve.
Thank you. I'm just going to make 3 points that just draw on the written submission that we gave at the Fraser Valander. So there are 3 key areas that I would like to highlight that is causing problems in terms of being able to do effective analysis of quality and human rights in relation to the budget. So the first of those things relates to data. And there's 2 areas. Firstly, it's upon how different taxation or expenditure policies impact on different groups of the population. We do not have very good data that disaggregates by groups of interest for this committee and for many others. And often we just use these headline aggregations of disability or ethnic minority, when actually that gives very little insight into the sort of the reality that people with different characteristics in our population are facing. To somebody with a physical disability, its experiences life very different from somebody with a learning disability. But we do not have the ability in the data we have often to disaggregate that. And the second is understanding the wealth and the income distribution in Scotland, but also how those two relate. So we know about the income distribution, we know about the wealth distribution, and we know things about you know, the value of property in Scotland, but there isn't a capability to tie those things together. So if you're looking to do analysis of replacing council tax, for example, with a property tax, it's actually very difficult to understand how that would impact on different groups of the population in terms of income and indeed protected characteristics. So the second area, which is something I'd like to focus on, is about the linking up of the policy cycle and how that can help with scrutiny from committees like this. So it's an area that I think the Scottish Government would admit sometimes it's quite weak on, particularly in terms of evaluation of policies and whether they have met their aims. But there's also the appraisal process, which we would expect all policies to go through in order to establish the costs and benefits of different options. Then it would go through implementation, and there should be a clear line to the budget in order to see what's been allocated and what's been spent. And then indeed there should be an evaluation following that looks at the impact of that spend and whether it's achieved its aims, as I said. That process is lacking in the work of the Scottish Government. And I think, as my colleague Angela said, a lot more scrutiny of that would be beneficial. And lastly, it's the transparency of the actual budget process and documentation itself. So myself and my colleagues at Fraser Valander do spend many hours trying to sift through budget documents to try and understand what's in the figures. It's not easy. And it's incredibly difficult to look across years, to look at how spending has changed in different areas over years. And that is something we believe could be improved, and the Scottish Government would have the capability of improving that. But it also feeds through to other areas of spend in year, and also the local government allocations. Well, there is quite good statistical publications that document local government spend. But again, it can be impossible to link those up year by year and actually look at trends over time. And you need a forensic eye in order to do that. And so it's not accessible to the general public or indeed, I think, to many parliamentarians. So those were the three things I just wanted to highlight. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much. And Chris Burt.
Thanks, Gavina. I'll concentrate perhaps expectedly on poverty. We have child poverty targets, which every party in the Parliament is signed up to, which are very challenging, rightly so. And by 2030-31, the main target is that relative child poverty should be below 10%. I think it's worth just pausing for a moment and reflecting just how different a Scotland that would be to the Scotland we see today. It's around 25% at the moment. And the things which Emma has just talked about, the distribution of income, wealth and power within our society, would have to significantly change to meet that. And that's obviously a goal that we would support and would urge everyone in the Parliament to push towards. And one thing that I would focus on, I would encourage a committee to focus on, is the Scottish Government rightly identified priority groups when they were setting their Tackling Child Poverty delivery plan. And around 80% of all the children who live in poverty are in one of those groups. But as Emma has highlighted, while that's a large group of people, none of them are the same. And yet at the moment, we have a lot of policy which focuses on general support to people and misses the individual impacts that will have on individuals. So I'd really encourage the committee to think about it through that lens. We will not meet our child poverty targets if we do not do better in the support that we provide for anyone in those priority group families. So I really encourage you to focus on that. The other thing is that we have an interim child poverty target, which has to be met by the end of financial year 2023-24, which is April 2024, and we're some way off it at the moment. So we need urgency and pace to get there. And just finally, on some of the questions that the committee has raised, there's been a perhaps understandable focus on raising revenue and how we might raise more revenue. Now, that may very well be part of the story of how we meet those long-term targets, but we already spend a lot of money and we don't know particularly well how that's impacting on poverty or on, frankly, much else. So while I can, you know, sometimes our debate comes down to what can we raise through extra tax and what Barnett consequentials are coming. That's obviously an important part of the discussion. But how we are spending current funds, you know, 30-odd billion pounds is a lot of money. So that could have, it is having positive impacts, of course it is. But are there ways in which we could target that more to head towards these targets, which are rightly challenging and we need to strive to get towards them?
Okay, thank you very much. As I think a couple of the panellists had mentioned, this is the first time I think that this committee, well, any committee of the Parliament, have tried to take a human rights approach to our budget scrutiny. So we're in a bit of a learning process too. I guess it would be helpful if the panellists wanted to give us any particular pointers into areas where we need to make sure we get things right. I think, Emma, you mentioned data, so maybe you want to start by pointing out some of the areas of data we need to push the government or other agencies in terms of clarifying to help us do our job in terms of making sure we are taking a human rights approach. So, Emma.
Yeah, so it's a big topic. So at the moment, for a lot of the analysis that the government produces, so for example, on the impact of taxation on different groups, it will come from existing surveys, usually UK-wide surveys. So It's the survey of personal incomes, which is very good for income tax, the family resources survey that looks at incomes and characteristics of family, which is where the poverty statistics are derived from. And then the living cost and food survey is another one that's used. So there are existing surveys, and as I believe it's right to say, the Scottish Government does pay for a boost to at least a couple of those surveys in order to increase the sample size for Scotland. But still, the sample size is relatively low, and it's quite difficult for the Scottish Government to, you know, to get changes made to those surveys, either ONS or DWP, HMRC data sets. So there could really be a shift in terms of thinking about investment in data in Scotland. But it is a big investment. I think that's very clear. But it would allow potentially for there to be boost to samples for particular groups, such as ethnic minority groups, and to actually understand some of those characteristics in terms of different disabilities, as I mentioned, that perhaps aren't, you know, on the radar so much of the DWP or the ONS as much as they are in Scotland, I think. So it's something that I think hasn't really been grasped as it could be. And I think it would have benefits both for things like budget scrutiny and for planning and operation of the social security system in terms of looking at changes that might be made there. Actually understanding who would benefit from that, I think, would be something I would like it to be considered a lot more.
Okay, thanks. Chris, do you want to add anything?
Not a lot. I mean, I would agree with what Emma said.
Alison or Angela, do you have any further comments, or are we around scrutiny and...
I was going to...
Yeah.
Will I come in now?
Yeah,
right, okay. Good. I was letting Ali come in there, but I suppose I would maybe... One of the things we've recommended within EBAG, looking at the Scottish Government, but it also applies to the Parliament, and in conversations with SPICE, we've talked about this. I think there is a need, and I say this, you know, entirely respectfully, but a need for building knowledge on human rights, the human rights instruments and obligations, understanding minimum core, and interpreting and applying data in equalities data that colleagues have been talking about, in the scrutiny of the budget and outcomes, and picking up on Chris's point, you know, that scrutiny of outcomes from spending. And I think also that requires an improvement in the quality of human rights and equalities analysis within government and within the Parliament. And I also think it's about members being perhaps a bit more demanding in terms of requesting or the quality of human rights and equalities analysis that is brought forward to you for scrutiny. There needs to be, I think, a greater, you know, challenge function around the extent to which proposals coming before committees will or are focused on transforming the status quo in relation to equalities and the realisation of rights.
Okay, sorry, and Alison?
I don't have too much to add to all of the points that have already been made, but I would reiterate the difficulty that we've had in doing some of this in being able to access the right data, so that the right data isn't there. And financial data, to, as Emma had said before, over time, being able to look at the changes and patterns and how that relates to realisation of rights is just not possible to do at the moment. We are aware that the Exchequer is doing a good programme of work over fiscal transparency, which will help with, hopefully over the next few years with that data. But at the moment, there are limitations to what we can do. But understanding, as Angela said, that the degree to which the government is realising rights, whether it's meeting the minimum core obligations or indeed progressively realising rights, we can't make those assessments just now, and we need better data to be able to do that.
Okay. And back to maybe one of the points that Angela made, that this committee has written to other committees to make the point that our human rights approach isn't just for this committee, and it's something that we're asking all committees of the Parliament to look at as they do their budget scrutiny. Carol.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This has been really fascinating, actually. And I was just thinking, really, around governments, you know, there are governments around the world that are experimenting with constructing their budget processes around well-being. And Scotland is learning from these experiments and looking at this, how this is going to help us formulate those budgetary processes, particularly in relation to children and to child poverty. So I'd like to ask, do you feel there's often a trap within the, you know, a service mindset? Is the process easy enough to understand and influence for those who are seeking to influence it? And could you give us some examples of where this has been done successfully in other countries? Thank you.
Okay, who wants to go first? Sorry, Alison.
I suppose an honest answer to that final point is that this is groundbreaking work. Taking a rights-based approach to budget analysis and to budgeting is not done in a lot of places, especially at a national level. There are some examples, there's good examples of work that the committee could look to, particularly produced by the Centre of Economic and Social Rights in New York. They've done some really good work with the Spanish civil society in preparing their submissions, their shadow reports on the review of the Economic, Social and Cultural Rights Treaty, where they were able to use a lot of budgetary data to highlight where there were alternatives to austerity that the government hadn't considered before cutting budgets, where money and resources could have been taken from in terms of tax evasion, avoidance and debt. That would have superseded the need to actually have the austerity cuts that they did. So there are ways of doing that scrutiny, and there are good examples of that. But actually taking a rights-based approach to the budget would be very novel, and it would be it would be groundbreaking in terms of a national government. I think there is a lot of support that we can offer, and there's a lot of capacity building required, as Angela mentioned before, in relation to understanding what the minimum core obligations are, what progressive realisation means, and enabling government departments to be able to think in that way when they are developing their budgets. But it would be a new process, and that there's no denying that.
Okay, thank you.
In terms of wellbeing budgeting, just one comment on wellbeing. There's a danger that the wellbeing focus is the next new shiny thing. And I don't mean that with any disrespect, but we have a tendency to focus on one way of doing things and then another way of doing things and then another way, instead of looking actually a lot of these ways have all got similar underpinnings and they're all linked, and well-being and human rights are inextricably linked. But what I don't think the government has done sufficiently yet is define what it means by well-being and look at the human rights underpinnings to that well-being process that could enable better definitions of what you're trying to achieve and how we will know if we've reached those outcomes and how the budget fits into that.
Okay, thank you. I think Angela would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much, Ms. Adams, for your question. I'll pick up where Ali left off there, which is to say that we can see around the world, and we can see in Scotland, an appetite for different approaches to budgeting, and whether that's on the more kind of technical side of, you know, performance-based or outcomes budgeting, but also trying to use the budget, use public finance processes as a means to deliver some of the social policy and economic policy outcomes. New Zealand has attempted wellbeing budgeting, but the critique there is that it wasn't very strongly gendered. There wasn't very strong intersectional analysis in their approach. Similarly, in Bhutan, a focus on well-being, but not understanding what we've already been talking about and that Chris talked about in terms of your generalised support missing priority groups. Iceland has committed to gender budgeting, but in common with many other countries, has found that process to be quite challenging in terms of turning around some very well established processes within government. Ireland, the Republic of Ireland, are learning from Scotland, so we need to start running back again to catch back up with our neighbours. But they've taken an approach which is one, I think, of or is approximating a kind of layering where they started on gender budgeting, now they've added some equalities budgeting, now they're looking to add environmental budgeting. And I think we need to maybe guard against that. And that's a conversation that we've already had within EBAG, that we need to firstly guard against these different approaches being seen as competitive or alternatives, but rather we should look at them as layered, as contributing to one another, and that an equalities and human rights lens takes us into children's rights, takes us into the environmental policies and the climate crisis, takes us into the advancement of social care, or and ultimately, you know, well-being in social and economic terms. So I would encourage us to explore these options, to take the lessons that we can, but really to not see them as alternatives, but as part of a whole and a whole systems change, because that's ultimately what we're trying to effect.
Okay, Chris Burt.
One thing just to keep in mind is a certain kind of mysticism about this, that there's a human rights budgeting, there's well-being budgeting, all these kind of things. It's maybe I overly simplify things, but what we're really talking about here is having a really good understanding of what we want to do, then looking at how we think we're going to get there, looking carefully at the impacts that our approach will have on different people, not just on everyone, and then working out whether or not that's happening. And if we get it wrong, starting again and doing it a different way. Now, politics doesn't always lend itself to a government saying, actually, sorry, I've got this wrong. Could we do it another way, please? But I would perhaps encourage a bit more of that thinking. But that's really difficult to do when you don't have the data to underlie it. So it's perfectly reasonable for ministers to stand up and say, I want to achieve this thing. I'm going to spend X on doing it and have these policies. And then after a year, say, look, we've looked at the data and it's not having the impact we expected. So we're going to do something different. That is good policy making. At the minute, it's kind of considered bad politics, but we don't have some of the data to underlie that. So I'd really encourage, that's where the scrutiny role of committees like your own can be really important. But to come back to Gavina's, some of the original questions, is it easy to cut through this? Is it easy to understand this? Not at all. So I would encourage simplicity in how we break down these issues into little bits of logic, which make it far easier than trying to look at a £35 billion budget and thinking, are we doing human rights?
Okay. Yep.
Just to add a couple of points based on your question. So in terms of the international approaches, so we've looked a little bit at New Zealand and written a bit about this. And I guess there were two things that stand out from their approach. It was their approach. I'm not sure quite how things have developed since. One was about the sort of collaboration between departments and ministers when they propose a new spend, that it was very much encouraged and would be scored more highly in terms of the budget process if there was two ministers kind of agreeing on it. So it was dual aims, I suppose. So, and it would take into account different opinions and different objectives of different departments, but working together in order to achieve that. And the second was about looking at where things aren't working, which builds on Chris's point. So as well as looking at where new spend should be, actually looking at us, so where should we be reducing spend because it's not working? And that I agree. It's very rare to see that in Scotland, but that's crucial. Looking at what works and what doesn't work, they should be hand in hand. And just separately, in terms of being able to understand the budget process and the figures. As I said, it's very difficult from the budget documents and at budget time. It's for many reasons, in which some are with the control of the Scottish Government, but it's very rushed and it's very hard to understand and what's gone in to the budget, why, and what the impacts are thought to be, all of those kind of things. But we're not an organisation that tries to kind of, influence or recommend policy, but we are very interested in understanding the data, and we do find that civil servants are very happy to explain and talk us through things in the months following. It's not that they're necessarily secretive about it. It's it's at that kind of official level. It's more that at the actual time that the budget is being produced and put out there and, you know, being scrutinised by Parliament, there isn't the time then, and there isn't the transparency then when it would be really critically needed because of the timings. I think that's a big part of it. But yeah, but subsequently to that, you know, we are able to kind of, over the course of a year, be able to kind of get our heads around it with the help of officials to do that. But it can be a bit of a struggle.
Okay, thank you. Maggie?
Thanks very much. Welcome to everybody who's joined us this morning, and thank you for your comments so far. It's been really, really interesting. I want to just pick up and maybe try and tease out some of the connections and issues that we have. We've talked about a problem of data. We've talked about the shiny new thing, and, you know, being cautious around that. And I totally get that. I suppose one of the things, Chris, you talked about where we want to get to and having that vision as being really, really clear. Does the panel, do you all think that we actually understand, if we talk about some of the technical language in this around a minimum core, or, you know, what it actually means to live in dignity? Do we have a shared understanding of that? And if not, what is the work that we need to do to ensure that we do across the different sectors that and different sort of priority groups or other demographics? How do we ensure that we do have that understanding so we can then make sure we are collecting the right data, that we are delivering the right kind of vision and not being sidetracked into the sort of mysticism of it all? I don't know which of you wants to go first on that one, Chris?
Okay, Chris first and then Alison.
Yeah, I mean, I'll defer to Ali on sort of definitions around minimum core and things like that. But I think it's a really important question. I think it's why the work that the Scottish Government has started on things like a minimum income guarantee is really important, because that shouldn't be a single policy solution of, well, let's just talk about Social Security. And once we've talked about Social Security, we'll fix that and everything's fixed. That should be a fundamental statement of the kind of basic level of support that our state will provide to everyone. And for some people, that will be through Social Security. But for others, that will be how they work, and we can look at the role of unpaid care and all of these kind of things. So I think it's vital, as we progress policies like that, which are long-term, which can't happen overnight and shouldn't, because they need to be designed with the people that they are designed to help. And I think that's absolutely crucial. I mean, I'm sorry, I missed the earlier part of Karen's question about how easy is it us to influence the budget. For an organisation like JRF, it's reasonably easy because we have access, we have power, which we hold, and we try to give that over to the people that we are trying to represent. But if you are Joe or Jane Public, I mean, it's impossible. I mean, literally impossible. How would you be able to piece together? As Emma says, it takes people like us a year to work it out, because it's so complex. It's the complexity is built in, and it's part of that power dynamic. So how we unpick that is really important.
Okay. Yep.
I would just say, in terms of, you know, do we have that shared knowledge and understanding? I think we think we do. I think it's something that's sometimes assumed, but is not borne out in terms of that kind, when you dig under a little bit, and then actually, you know, very simple questions that you would hope you'd be able to ask and get an answer to, like, so how much are you spending on tackling child poverty? What impact do you expect it to have? You can't at the moment ask those questions and get an answer that's robust and rigorous, because there isn't that infrastructure behind those decisions at the moment that enables, you know, ministers or the civil service to be able to fully answer that. So I think it's that kind of integrity of the analysis that underpins many of these statements, that, you know, and that comes back to the capacity of the civil service and the priority it's given within decision making, and, you know, what those signals are in terms of what priority should be given to this type of analysis. I think a lot of the skills are there to do it. It's just sometimes not given the right focus, and we've already talked about data, but I think that's part of it as well.
Okay, and Alison would like to come in as well.
I suppose that the demystifying element around human rights language, and like Chris said before about, you know, like actually keeping things simple. Minimum core is simple. It's red lines below which we do not accept as a society that we should fall. Now, the minimum core is a global thing. And of course, there are debates and there are philosophical debates around whether or not there is a relative or an absolute. And for a country like Scotland and the wealth that Scotland has, that our minimum should maybe not be as low as it is in other countries. And then we look at our levels of food poverty, the use of food banks, the amount of homelessness, and we are not meeting the minimum core at a global level under those rates. So I think there is a need to have a national discussion around what do we think that minimum core is and what should it be for Scotland. And for me, that is part of an integral part of the development of the new legislation. So what are those red lines going to be within that legislation? And how do people understand what a life of dignity means to them? And that is a conversation that needs the participation of everybody, and particularly vulnerable groups and those who are least heard from. And that right to participate, that right to participate in those discussions around what's going to impact in your life is absolutely critical. It's critical to a shared understanding of what these more complex, but not actually very difficult when we translate them, concepts mean, and also a way of people understanding that these rights are relevant to them. And I think that will help across the public and also public sector about understanding what bringing rights home actually means, and what realising rights and what progressively realising rights means. But I think that can all be part of a conversation that's a critical conversation in the development of that new legislation.
Angela's want to come in, but I'm going to ask Pam to come in first, and then we'll go to Angela.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and thank you very much for your submissions and also for the discussion this morning. It's really, really helpful, as my colleagues have said. I wanted just to dig a little bit more into the minimum core for some specific groups of people. So notwithstanding the significant gaps in data that you've all highlighted and that we really do need to address, and I hope that's something that we can do, there are clear, I think, from the data that does exist, some problems with the minimum core, particularly around disabled people. So, for example, the SHRC's paper during the summer around the impact of COVID restrictions and social care on disabled people's rights, and some people, you know, living entire days and weeks and months in one chair. We've heard about the Fraser Valander. You've done some really good research recently on the minimum core of rights of people with a learning disability. And of course, there's the significant work that's going in around child poverty and the fact that so many children are living in poverty and not getting an adequate standard of living in that respect. So what are the panel's views? Could you say a little bit more about the detail of those minimum core and what data you've used to tell that story and how important it is? And also, could you talk a little bit about what it means for addressing some of those gaps, particularly in relation to how we use our public spend, social security, the way that we see the care service working, particularly for women or disabled people? It'd be really good just to hear a bit about that, if that's OK.
Okay, so we'll go to Angela first.
OK, thanks very much, convener. That's OK. Thank you very much. That's OK. Ms. Duncan Glancy, you raise hugely important issues, and that they reflect the comments Chris made earlier on about understanding through data, but through more than the data, through services having a relationship with people in communities, and understanding what lived experience actually means for different people. And that is absolutely about the point that Chris has also made, focusing on the objectives. What is it that we want to see as a country, as a society, and make decisions and then formulate processes around them that will deliver that? And it also means, I think, we've been talking about this since the inception of the Parliament, to move policy away from a kind of siloed approach to thinking, and to seeing, for example, social care as a human rights issue, as a social policy issue, as an economic issue, as an economic policy issue. If we invest in social care, we're investing in quality of life, we're investing in active citizenship, we're investing in the workforce, and we're investing in growing an economy. That for 2% of GDP invested in care creates three times as many jobs as are created in construction. The Feely Review of Adult Social Care suggested that we need an increase in investment of 0.4%. Now, that would only take us up to 2.66% of GDP, in contrast to Sweden's level of 4.81% in terms of spending on social care. And so that example, I think, illustrates a point that these considerations around the realisation of rights and the advancement of equality are not the focus of this committee, but have to be the focus of every other committee in the Parliament. And that's also then about coherence. And to relate that back to Ms. Chapman's question about, is there a shared understanding? No, there's not. Is there a shared understanding? Do we all actually have a shared understanding or same level of knowledge about the budget process? Who amongst us can talk fluently, apart maybe from Chris, about the fiscal framework? And so that means an investment of time and an investment of resource in building that knowledge amongst our policymakers and amongst the public. And one of the things that we've suggested in EBAG and that echoes some of the calls from the Citizens' Assembly is for a citizens' budget. And that's in relation, firstly, to the documentation and the process. We could, of course, go further and think about that in terms of co-production and participation in national budget processes. But I'll stop there and let others come in.
Thanks very much. I'm just conscious of where we are in terms of time, so we're all going to have to, members and panel, all just be a little bit tighter in terms of making sure we're sharper with answers. I guess we don't have to hear from everyone, but Chris, I'm sure that the questions that we've just heard from Pam, you'd be keen to comment on.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'll keep it brief, but I mean, Pam, you're absolutely right. The experience of disabled people within Scotland, you're far more likely to be in poverty. If you're a child in a family where somebody is disabled, you're again far more likely to be in poverty. And we can see that there is a different experience, say within housing. If you're in a family where somebody is disabled, you're far more likely to be in poverty purely because of your housing costs alone. And I think we are starting to see in Scotland that we now do have powers over things like disability assistance payments, where we need to take a more fundamental look at what the purpose of those payments is and what role they can play in lifting people out of poverty, because they don't at the moment. And I think the way in which they have been designed, with people who are going to be eligible to those payments at their core, so that the process should be a far more dignified process than you would get at the moment from the DWP, is exactly the same process we should be going through in how we design the policy as they change, as we go forward and reform them, because that is a vital lever that we have to improve lives of disabled people in Scotland.
And Emma, there was a reference to yourself. So.
Yeah, so in terms of learning disabilities, as you say, we've done quite a lot of work, and I've actually been shocked, actually, at the state of the understanding and the data and the knowledge of the pretty much, you know, all aspects of public and civil society in terms of understanding the issues around learning disability. We've kind of stated that we believe it's population that's pretty much invisible, because there's been so little investment in data or understanding about the issues that are faced. But one thing we've looked at is trying to understand where there is data and actually producing our own data. So there's a lot of analysis we've done on that. But just coming back to that about disability and poverty and carers and poverty, something we put out last week looked at unpaid carers, person with learning disability, and over half of those households that we surveyed were living in poverty because of the fact that they can't take up paid employment, as well as being a full-time unpaid carer. The carer's allowance doesn't touch the side. So that's something in terms of how the budget could operate in terms of alleviating that. And then, there's a lot that's going on. It's just all kind of, it's not well appreciated, I think, by ministers and kind of core civil service in terms of what learning disability is and what can actually be done to help. Underinvestment in social care and money kind of disappearing in the social care system and people having to fight tooth and nail to get any support. You know, we hear that time and time and again. It's something we believe needs more visibility, and it's core to a lot of what we're talking about in terms of that kind of understanding of what human rights approach is and actually who is it that we're talking about in terms of groups of protected characteristics. We're really bad at it.
Okay, thanks for that. And Alison, you're wanting to comment as well.
A couple of really brief points. Pam mentioned the care report that the Commission had produced in the summer, and you know, for the most part, some abject failures in realising the rights of people with disabilities in terms of care provision that was found. And I think self-directed support and the provision of personal cares and support is a really good example of where you can have good policy. And this is important when we're reviewing the development of a new national care service. You know, what is policy failure and what is failure to fund the right policy? And to make sure that we're not throwing out good ideas by not realising that actually these ideas have not been resourced properly in the first place. So actually properly resourcing good policy, you can have the best law and policy, but if you don't resource it properly, you're not going to get the outcomes that you're looking for. And in relation to digging a bit deeper in terms of minimum core at the international level, there's a wealth of guidance around what minimum core could and should mean in different national contexts, without prescribing, but with giving ideas. And that is a good place to start, looking at the general comments that are produced by the different treaty bodies and looking elsewhere to see what other countries are also doing. But that's where you'll find some really useful guidance as a starting point to then have that national discussion around what do we consider is appropriate for Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go to Pam Gossel next.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome and good morning to the panel. Thank you for the opening discussion. It was really helpful. With human rights budgeting being so new, do you know of any lessons learned from international comparators on equalities in human rights budgeting, and which countries or regions can Scotland learn from?
Okay, who would like to go first? Anyone there? We've lost Angela.
Sorry,
anyone in the room wanting to? Can I go first? Right. Okay. So I think we've lost both of them. So, Angela, are you able to come in? Angela.
I don't think they can hear us.
No. Alison.
Oh. That's us back. I'm sorry, I think Angela and I both lost the reception at the same time and we didn't hear the question.
Do you want to quickly go again? Yep.
With human rights budgeting being so new, do you know of any of the lessons learned from international comparators on equalities in human rights budgeting, and which countries and regions can Scotland learn from?
Angela, do you want to go first? I think you mentioned
I think
you mentioned some of this earlier, didn't you? So maybe you can expand a little.
I did, and I wouldn't necessarily take a lot of time to recap. I think there's different things to learn from different countries. The constitutional requirement within Austria, so gender budgeting is built into those requirements. Similarly in Iceland, human rights budgeting, as Ali has said, is newer. But we have opportunity in Scotland to learn from those other countries who have ensured that budget and public finance processes are part of incorporation. And that's something that, you know, there is a job for this committee and other committees as the incorporation agenda moves forward in Scotland. So how are we tying in everything that we're saying about financial scrutiny, about Emma's points on the policy cycle, tying in appraisal, implementation and evaluation, and doing that from a human rights-based approach, which is to say, what is it, you know, how are things experienced currently, what do we need to change, and how are we going to get there? And that really is the most kind of straightforward way. And for committees, now one of the things that Scotland is different from in that we do have much more contact with the committee. We do have, even though it is incredibly difficult to follow the budget process and the budget documentation, we do have a more open budget and in many other countries. However, it still has then the status of being hidden in plain sight, in a sense. And so opening up greater participation, taking some of the lessons from participatory budgeting in Scotland and internationally, around participation and engaging beyond consultation. But I see Ali's going to come in, so I'll stop talking and let Ali come in.
Okay, Alison.
I was just going to say, in relation to that point, the Open Budget Survey is a useful place to go to in terms of the index that they produce is a global index of the level of participation, accountability and scrutiny that the governments are under in terms of their budget process. And that was where we'd originally gone when we couldn't interrogate the budget ourselves, when we were trying to do some human rights analysis of the budget. We thought, let's look to the process first. So improving our process, improving participation in the budget, improving the accountabilities and transparency of data. There are 117 countries involved in that index, and looking globally, therefore, to their experience of who's got the higher indexes than Scotland's comparative scores will be a good place to start in terms of improving our processes. But to be fair, that the budget review that Angela was part of in 2017 and the committee's subsequent inquiry, which has looked at issues of process, we know what we need to do. And I think it's just a case of ensuring that those processes are improved.
OK, thank you. I think that takes us to Alexander.
Thank you, Convener, and can I welcome everyone to the panel and the discussion we've had. I want to tease out slightly more when it comes to the idea of engagement and participation. Each one of you and your organisations are actively involved, and you are supporting us in this Parliament and government and MSPs and how you progress. So we can learn a lot from what you'd say in your participation, but it's how we expand that participation and ensure that we get the accountability and we get the transparency. Because, you've mentioned today specific locations in other countries and other areas that have actively engaged. Now, some of these have the citizen budget, and some of these develop some of that role to ensure that there is much more of an inclusion. But there are also barriers that we find. And you've identified today that it's a complex process and you need to be quite forensic as to how you manage that. And things can be misrepresented or they can be hidden in the process of trying to see how it all works. So I'd like to sort of tease out from you all or whoever wishes to answer about how you feel we can stop the barriers, how you feel that we can actually engage, because we think we're engaging, but obviously that's not everyone's opinion. Our engagement is slightly less than other countries and other regions' engagement. But at the same time, we're all trying to get as much information out there as possible. So it would be good to hear your views on what we need to do more and what we need to do to engage and ensure that we get that transparency, that we get that participation and we get that scrutiny.
OK, Alison, do you want to kick off?
I think from our perspective, a good place to start is looking at what we mean by participation and meaningful participation. And when we look at a lot of government and parliament consultations, the time that is not given for responses. I was really pleased to see the focus, the human rights focus within this call for evidence, but a very short time frame for people to actually respond and to respond meaningfully. And those who we are trying to engage with, those who are least engaged with these processes, probably need the most time. And not just in terms of time resource, but monetary resource for bringing together people. Resources were taking on board that people's working patterns, if you're trying to engage with people, childcare responsibilities, other care responsibilities, if you're wanting to actually bring people physically together. And I think there's a lot of talk, the Programme for Government, I think we mentioned 67 times the word consultation or consult, and the need to consult with people's lived experience, which is great to see. But I think there's consultation, and consultation doesn't always mean participative engagement. And I think having a set of standards for participation, what people can expect from the process, to be defined and to be across all of the different types of consultations and engagements that government and parliament have would be useful, so I sort of set a standard. And the right to participate, there's a lot of information, again, internationally around what makes for good participation and democratic participation. And I think having a set of standards for Scotland would be a good idea as to people know what to expect, and it will help parliamentarians and public bodies know what they should be doing to better engage with people.
Okay, thank you. Chris?
I think you'd say a couple of things here. Both Emma and Pam touched on some people fighting tooth and nail to get things to change. So I'm sure almost all of us will have had examples over, particularly over the pandemic, of family members or friends who've had to fight with public services or fight with other people to feel like they're vindicating their rights. And I think we would also, we might feel that in the policy development process as well. Because, yes, having people's experience and engagement and participation is vital, but it's then what do you do with it? For example, we did a report with single parents earlier in the year, and one of the main findings from them was, we are sick of telling you the same thing over and over again. I don't want to participate. I don't want somebody to hear my story. I want you to fix it. So I think that's the thing. People are speaking. Are we really listening? So yes, there are many different processes and tools to get people's participation, and the more of those we use, the better. And I do think across the political spectrum, there is a lot of support for that, which is great, but really we need to listen. And that kind of fighting tooth and nail thing is something we hear all the time. It's not necessarily to do with budgets, although budgets for group advocacy groups, for advice group and rights groups are vital in that, but it's about listening.
Good. Emma?
Very briefly, just from the perspective of an organisation like ours, in terms of actually being able to have more meaningful kind of dialogue, I suppose, with ministers in terms of parliamentary scrutiny, I think really thinking about the sort of the questions that are being asked of ministers in terms of actually understanding the underpinning of policies that are being made. There are a lot of announcements made. There are a lot of different times in the year when announcements are made. That's kind of scrutiny of, why is that decision being made? What is the evidence that underpins that? What is the expectation you have that this will achieve? And how are you going to measure it? I think getting that kind of thing more routinely discussed and on the public record would be a good step forward. And I think in terms of the scrutiny of this type of thing, there aren't that many organisations in Scotland. We don't have a big kind of legacy of sort of think tanks. There are relatively few organisations that can do that kind of scrutiny of the budget. So it's a difficult one to think about how you support that, but it's something that the Parliament could think about.
So who's next? Sorry, Angela,
Just very briefly, I would absolutely endorse everything that's been said. I think one thing to add is Spice do a good job in terms of making some of the budget information a bit more accessible, but there's an awful lot more could be done by both the Parliament and government in terms of public information, transparency and simplicity in the budget documents. There's nothing more, I think, really to add to the comments colleagues have made about meaningful and inclusive participation. And there are some really important lessons to learn from our own experience in Scotland about where participatory budgeting has not been inclusive and fully participatory. There are some positive actions happening within the Scottish Exchequer, linked to the Open Government Action Plan, around making the budget more accessible, around opening up some of the data and documentation. And that might be something that the committee would like to keep an eye on, the progress of those positive projects.
Okay, thanks for that. Nods around the table there. Okay, thanks, Ekamut. Now move to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel from here at my office in Sunny Cote Bridge. I think this has been a really useful and interesting discussion today, and I think panel members and the rest of the committee will be glad to hear that my questions are really quite general. A lot of it's already been touched on, but I suppose it will give panel members a chance to home in on any points that you wish to make. Because one of the areas that we hear often quite a lot about is MSPs on committees and, you know, even just in our daily work, is that gap between, and I know it's been referred to already, between what's agreed or said at a policy level and how it's implemented. And I'm wondering if, I'm quite easy with whatever order the convener chooses, if there's anything that you think we can do there to improve that, to improve, you know, what the policy intention are, is, and what the how that's enacted on the ground.
Okay, we'll start with Chris, because I think it's an area you mentioned earlier in your contribution, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a great one for process, so sometimes I'm not best place to answer these things. But I think, I mean, I've written down here, I was hoping that the cameras couldn't see it. But there's a certain amount of me which just thinks we need to get on with stuff. And we need to get on with looking at how it's working and trying to under that gap Fulton's mentioned about, well, here's our policy and here's the implementation of it. We just kind of, we let the implementation happen, however it happens, without really knowing what's going on and what the outcomes are. And therefore, if we don't see much change in very high level poverty stats, we just kind of go, well, we need to do more. Maybe we need to tax more. Maybe we need to spend more. But we're kind of missing the obvious question that's sitting in front of us. So I think it's really vital. I maybe encourage the committee to break this down a bit, focus on a particular group, really put your efforts into it. As you say, you know, make it relevant, because sometimes these discussions that we have in Parliament are quite distant to the experience that people are having out in communities across Scotland. So pick something that feels really relevant and, you know, put a microscope on it and say, look, how is this working? Not to set a political trap, but to improve the lives of the people that we are all trying to improve the lives of.
Okay, thank you. Emma?
It would be remiss of me not to mention this, so I will do it now. But I'll go back to the experience of reform of council tax in Scotland and how the ambitions of, you know, subsequent governments to change the system entirely have not really happened on the ground. Despite many commissions, myself was on the secretariat for one, you know, looking at ways in which to do that. So I think in terms of the work of the committee and the Parliament in general, I think that when there are these really difficult decisions to be made, and council tax is one of the most, you know, would be the, yeah, it's incredibly difficult to reform it. We all know why, and that's, we know why it hasn't been done. But if we look at examples from, for example, Northern Ireland, who did bring through a change in their rate system in the not too distant past, it was a sort of a joint effort from the parties to realise how difficult it was to reform it, and to basically, you know, join hands and just be a united force in saying we have to do this, we have to push it through, because otherwise it's the inequalities it's causing are just going to get worse and worse and worse. So there is lessons to be learned maybe from experiences of reforming things like property taxation that might be relevant to the work of this committee in actually making progress.
Okay, thank you. And Fulton, do you want to come back in before we move to Alison and Angela?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, convener, because I had a wee specific question for Emma, if that's okay. And because didn't choose an order, I didn't know when people were coming in. And can I apologise to people who are on the chat? I put a wee note on the chat there to come back in, and I did not mean for the second half of that sentence to be in capitals. So there you go. Emma, I just wanted to ask you, while you're kind of summing up as well, about your views on the National Care Service, because I know that you did write something recently that was talking about the National Care Service being unlikely to do any better if it's underfunded, potentially, than the system it seeks to replace. I wonder if you're able to comment a wee bit on that in the grander scheme of things we're talking about just now.
So back to Emma, yeah.
So yes, it's already been mentioned by a colleague, I think, in terms of you can't expect different results. You might have the right policy, but if you don't fund them properly, the policy is likely to, you know, to fall over and not be an improvement on what's come before. And it's again, another area where it's extremely complicated to understand the funding that's going into this. And also, you know, even government announcements in terms of increases in funding, it's actually very difficult to understand exactly what that means. And it sounds ridiculous that that is the case. But that kind of clarity in terms of understanding the full extent of spending on, well, I mean, it's adult social care is the thing we specifically talk about. You know, what's being spent, why, who, what needs to change, and actually to have that really good shared understanding of the cost of the system and what is needed in order to improve it. And that was in the independent review, looked at some of those issues, but actually, again, it wasn't particularly clear in some of its analysis, which I think it speaks for the complexity of these issues. So, and if we don't have that transparency that helps us understand, you know, exactly what's going on in the system, then it'd be really hard to understand what's working and what's not working. And so it's something we're really keen to really hone in on, is that understanding of such an important issue and such a massive reform, actually understanding where the money is and following it.
Brilliant. Thank you. And moving to Angela.
Thank you, Convener. In response to Fulton's questions, I think my one word answer would be coherence, and that sometimes there is a lack of coherence across policy initiatives, policies and spending. And I think in an environment where we, I think, collectively can experience and maybe contribute to initiative overload, we need to encourage a bit of a step back and think, for example, the recent recommendations, the calls to actions from the Social Renewal Advisory Board have touched on many of the issues we've talked about today. So how is government going to report on those actions in terms of how they map on to the range of actions government are funding? But how is Parliament going to scrutinise the outcomes from those actions? And maybe rather than layering additional processes and actions, we need to remember that the National Performance Framework exists to monitor and to measure some of those outcomes, and to see consistently what the relationship is between policy and spending announcements, new or cumulative, new or revised, as the Budget Review Group and colleagues today have encouraged, and what outcomes are being achieved. And where the outcomes are not being achieved, what is the issue there? Is it spending or is it some other issue? And the example I want to use to illustrate that is a survey recently by Glasgow University for Food Train, who identified amongst the older adults in receipt of domiciliary social care, that amongst older adults in receipt of social care in this survey, 31% were malnourished. 31% were experiencing malnutrition. That's over and above the usual, and I can't believe that we have a usual measure of older adults who are at home on their own experiencing malnutrition of about around 12%. Now, is the problem there one of funding, or is the problem there one of the instrument, the time-limited provision that there is for supporting adults in receipt of domiciliary care? So the legislative instrument, rather than the budget, maybe, or at least the two combine. And so having that coherence when we come to the policy evaluation stage and to be looking at outcomes and what is producing certain outcomes that are realising the policy objectives or are creating other problems.
Okay, thank you. And Alison?
Picking up on three points from the previous speakers, in relation to Chris's point, I agree. Picking a group, picking a particular issue and looking at it in depth, really understand how you work through that process. But also, if you are focusing on a particularly vulnerable group, if you're then going to get it right for them, chances are you're going to get it right for others. I think that's a really useful, it's difficult sometimes to think about human rights budgeting on a kind of global issue. They hone down onto a particular point, and work out how to do that processing and that scrutinising and then build out from there. In relation to Emma's point, I fully support the need to look at taxation and local taxation. We've talked a lot about taxation and the value that brings to maximising resources. In Scotland, we do have limitations, but I think we also hide behind those limitations and we don't necessarily look what is fully possible within devolved competencies. And I think there are some good examples looking to Switzerland around local wealth taxation that are possible for us to look at. And there are people working on this in the UK. And I know that some submissions into the government's taxation framework are going to focus on that. So it's worth the committee looking at those issues. And then lastly, going back to Angela's point, that I think the domiciliary care issue brings it back also to data, the point we started the session on, where we, when we look at the types of provision of social care that people receive, we look at how many hours or how many minutes people are receiving, how many times they're seen per day, whether or not they're given, you know, like whatever services. We don't ask people and measure in whether or not and to the extent to which they're able to live independently because of the social care they receive. We don't ask the right questions in terms of the outcomes we're trying to achieve. So I think in terms of the data that we look to collect, we also need to think about what is it we're asking and why are we asking it, and are there better questions to actually get to the crux of whether or not people are able to live with dignity.
Okay, thank you very much. Unfortunately, time is against us on in terms of this panel. We probably could have gone on all day. This is we're at this as a committee, we're at the start of a process. So thank you all so much for the evidence you've given today. And I'll suspend briefly to change witnesses. Thank you. Okay, thanks everyone. Welcome back. And we now are going to hear from our second panel of witnesses. And again, one of our witnesses is joining us remotely, and we still have Fulton McGregor joining us remotely. So I welcome to the meeting Adam Stachura, Head of Policy and Communications at Age Scotland, Jatina Haria, Executive Director of CRER, Ailey Dixon, Policy and Parliament Manager in Gender, and Rob Gowans, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Health and Social Care Alliance. Again, I thank the witnesses for the written evidence, which has been really helpful in our deliberations, and we'll invite each member to give short opening statements, starting with Adam, please.
Well, look, thanks very much on behalf of Age Scotland for the invitation. I think in reflection, sort of the work that you're actually doing isn't straightforward. I think particularly getting to grips with the information from that first panel as well, but it's incredibly vital in terms of that scrutiny and supporting people to realise their rights and across this wider work of government and public services. With regard to older people, we know that realisation of rights can be a challenge, even when interacting with public services. And the events over the last 18 months have drawn in sharp focus many ways upon which older people have faced barriers to services, whether by the pausing of them or the removal of them entirely, or indeed the primarily sort of digital-only access towards them, which discounts at least 500,000 over 60s in Scotland from accessing the rights or information or any kind of services that they require. And indeed, health and social care and the challenges people have faced there in doing so. But looking ahead, we think it's vital that the budget and future budgets support the national recovery, of course, and meet the needs of an ageing population, which Scotland has. It is a population ageing faster than the rest of the UK, but often feel that we haven't really got to grips with that. It's not a problem, it's not a challenge, it's something that we have and we must embrace and support. So older people based in Scotland can enjoy a dignified later life and ensure that Scotland is the best place in the world to grow older.
Okay, thank you very much. And Chatton?
Thank you. So I think what I'd want to say is a lot of the issues on equalities and budgeting has already been said over many years and many, many times. I'm not sure there's a lot new to be said. The more recent report from the Equality Budget Advisory Group was useful, but again, it was saying things that have been said before. I suppose the new ask to make the recommendations into a prioritised and resourced action plan is useful, and you know we should push government to make sure that is done as a matter of great urgency. Having said that, and you touched on this in the earlier session, we should not be interested too much in processes and actions, but outcomes. That's what really makes a difference. So even in the EBAG report, for one example, on EQIAs, it talked about having to publish them and to have mandatory training. Well, the publication requirement has been a legal duty for many, many years now, and the training in itself will not necessarily make them any better. And then there's a question on joined up government as well. I think that was touched on as well. So in terms of that EQIA recommendation, the current public sector equality duty consultation that government is running at the moment doesn't even mention EQIAs. So there's a problem there. A lot of people have already said things about data, which I totally agree with, especially in the context of race. But again, it's not just about collecting better data or more data. It's about analysing that. So again, a quick example, I was looking at the Social Security child benefit take-up data, which shows for black minority ethnic families, the take-up or the application rate was around 7% in Scotland, which doesn't really tell us anything. We know the 4% BME population figure, but that was from the 2011 census. That is probably meaningless now. And we know that the BME population has a much younger profile. So there's probably a lot more families with young children who are from black minority ethnic communities. So we need to know what that figure is so we can see whether the 7% is a true reflection of what it should be or not. And just to close up then, maybe surprisingly, I'm not going to come here and ask for more money for anything necessarily. You know, the child benefit, child payment thing might be a separate issue, but in the main, for certainly for racial equality, it's not about more money. It's about better mainstreaming of race equality and elimination of discrimination, and that is back to outcomes. We need to see a change in people's lives from the work that we're doing. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And Ailey?
Thank you, Convener, and to the committee for inviting Engender to participate in this meeting. As we've outlined in the written submission that we've sent, we are really pleased to welcome the committee's focus on human rights budgeting and human rights-based approaches to budgeting. But that being said, we have previously and have again this year outlined our concerns that to the committee about the lack of attention in the existing Scottish budget process paying to structural inequality between women and men. In Scotland, we have numerous rhetorical commitments to an expanded and a solidified approach to gender budgeting in Scotland. However, the existing mechanisms and processes that we have to deliver that remain largely descriptive and are undermined, as Jatin alluded to there, by a lack of data, but also by capacity and prioritisation issues. Our written submission also outlines the critical role of the budget as a tool to respond to a widely recognised rollback in women's rights as a direct result of the COVID-19 pandemic. Through a spotlight on social care, which we've covered in our submission, social care has been seriously destabilised by interventions such as social distancing and isolation, offsetting care back from the state into the household, largely to be delivered by women. Which impacts obviously their own ability to stay in paid work, plunging them into poverty or often further poverty, and also their ability to undertake activities central to their own health and well-being. When it comes to human rights, women encounter different barriers to adequate housing, good health and income and other human rights because of an unequal access to resources, to safety and to power. But there appears to be limited detailed descriptions of how gender budgeting and human rights budgeting processes sit side by side and can mutually reinforce one another. We do cite work by the economist Diane Elson, which outlines the critical role of gender budgeting to the realisation of CEDAW, the Women's Bill of Rights. The Human Rights Bill, the forthcoming Human Rights Bill, and the Scottish Government's planned equality and human rights mainstreaming strategy might offer some opportunities to further embed these analyses in a complementary way. However, without the thorough cumulative analysis of the budget upfront, it's extremely difficult for Engender and other organisations to describe how that might be realised. So thank you, I'll leave that there.
Okay, thanks very much. And joining us online, Rob Gowans.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence to the committee this morning. The significant impact of COVID-19 and the responses taken to it will be felt for many years to come, including on the economy. The Alliance believes it's possible to embed equality, transparency and people's participation in Scotland's economy in order to achieve transformational and positive change that works for everyone. Under international human rights law, governments are obliged to respect, protect and fulfil human rights, and the way that public money is raised, allocated and spent is central to this. Adopting a human rights-based approach to Scotland's budget would embed human rights-based values like equality, transparency and participation in financial decision-making. To facilitate a shift towards equality in the Scottish budget process, governments should explicitly recognise rights in their budgetary decisions. This should identify economic, social and cultural rights, as well as rights for disabled people, women and minoritised communities, all of whom have been disproportionately affected by COVID-19. The budget's one of the main ways national governments show their priorities. If Scotland values and prioritises equalities and human rights, that should be reflected in the budget process. Human rights budgeting and the use of equalities and human rights impact assessments support prioritisation. Therefore, a common language and philosophy, as well as a framework and tools to balance competing interests and make fair judgments. Finally, the Alliance believes more sustainable resources are needed in Scotland's third sector and in the social care sector. The contribution of the third sector to Scotland's people, society and economy remains unrecognised and undervalued. Similarly, there have long been calls for greater investment in social care as part of the shift from acute services towards preventative community-based support, and more recently to fulfil the recommendations of the Independent Review of Adult Social Care. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Obviously, I don't know if you managed to see the last panel, but we mentioned there this is the first time that the committee has looked to take a human rights approach. Clearly, in the past, we've looked at gender and we've looked at equality budgeting. And maybe starting with Ailey, just to talk on how we make sure that these things don't end up conflicting and they all add value.
Thank you very much. I think what I want to re-stress about our written submission and the evidence I'm giving today is that we are not saying that human rights budgeting is in any way oppositional to gender budgeting. What we are saying is that we have had this focus on gender budget analysis and gender budgeting processes for a really long time, and yet we still have not delivered the transformational change that I think we want to see. In gender's experience, and I think that might be reflected by other equalities organisations, is that when we look across the board at mainstreaming duties and obligations in Scotland, the experience of layering more and more and more requirements on public bodies, including Scottish Parliament, has not necessarily led to greater outcomes or the kind of intersectionality that you might hope. Again, it's not to say that we don't want to focus on all of the protected characteristics, but we have not yet found a way to do that without diminishing the focus on one. And I think our concern about adding more into the budget process is of course, that there is that risk that we continue with the rhetorical commitments that we have to gender budgeting without actually seeing some of the process changes that we need to see. I'm by no means an expert in human rights budgeting. I think human rights budgeting, as we allude to in the written evidence, has to include gender budgeting because of the because women fit into every single group and women have human rights, obviously, but also because of the planned human rights incorporation agenda's focus on CEDAW and women's rights within that framework. So there will have to be some kind of complementary process. I think it's just how we figure out how to do that in a technical way as we move forward through that incorporation agenda.
Yeah. Thanks. I think that point of intersectionality is actually really important. Jatin, do you want to make a quick comment and then I'll bring in Pam?
Yeah, I mean, generally just agree with what Ailey's saying there. A long time ago, we argued against having this committee looking at equalities and human rights together. We argued it should be two separate committees. That would have solved your problem because you would have had two committees looking at two different things. But it's, I suppose, just to add to what Ailey was saying, though, we need to just be careful that it's not used as an excuse by people saying, well, human rights is a brand new thing and we need to take another couple of years to get our head around it. Whereas, you know, as has been said, gender, we've been looking at gender budgeting for so many years, we still haven't got that right. This might just give people an excuse to say, well, we've got something new to look at now.
Okay, I think Rob would like to come in.
Yes, thank you, convener. I think we believe that sort of greater weight should be given to progressive economic systems like human rights and gender budgeting, as well as the wellbeing caring economy. Let's say that sort of earlier this year, we organised a panel discussion with expert speakers to try and unpick the differences between some of these. And that event sort of demonstrated that rather than being sort of competing agendas, these systems have a lot in common and are complementary. So they put people at the centre of the economy and they share core values like equality and justice. So I think they can sort of live together and will complement each other rather than conflicting.
Okay, thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you so much for your submissions that were characteristically excellent from all of you and really helpful in terms of informing our work. So thank you. I have a particular question around human rights budgeting and specifically around the idea of a minimum core, which we heard a bit about this morning. There are a number of groups in society, notwithstanding the data gaps that you've mentioned, Jatin, and others have noted, there are a number of groups in society that it appears that there are that the minimum cores are not being met for example, women, disabled people, unpaid carers and children, particularly with the level of child poverty. Could you say a bit about how you think a human rights-based approach to budgeting and where the budget lines could go to start to address some of that, and in particular, some of the bigger sort of spend around social security or a national care service, for example, might be quite interesting. And I know that all of your submissions have pointed to, particularly the national care service, as something that could make an impact to women's and disabled people's equality, if that's okay.
Yep. Adam, do you want to kick off?
I'm trying to think of the best way to put it. It's quite hard, I think, especially as a charity, to think of like going across all the budget lines to work out where something could be spent less and something more. And actually, in the previous panel, Chris Burton made a really good point about outcomes and outcomes being talked here as well. And I think that's actually core part of this is the outcomes of previous actions and to see what's working or not and really properly evaluating that. Your point about the people who are sort of missed in terms of realisation of rights is absolutely spot on. And I think there are crises that we've faced that is, again, has drawn these things into sharper focus. And whether or not there is, do enough people care about that, I think is also a challenge, like to actually really take quick, big action to redress that. And people should be. But I think it's a difficult one for charity to go like where else without looking, you know, across all of the money spent. But the people you mentioned are the places where the focus needs to go. And yeah, looking for these outcomes, looking for these proper big intervention. The National Care Service would be a great example of what, you know, looking at a system just now which is okay for lots of people, but doesn't work for lots of people. And the idea behind it to try and create something new, which will maybe have more accountability, which maybe have better kind of equity of access, all these things as part of a structure will be as an important big step to trying to redress that. It won't necessarily, by virtue of having an institution, fix it overnight. It'll be about all the actions that are taken and that kind of scrutiny of them. But again, it's a very difficult one. But notwithstanding the fact that these things need to happen, that people need to be, we need to go beyond the minimum, don't we? You know, as a society in terms of our aspirations. And the fact that if we're not achieving that at all is quite scandalous.
Okay, Rob, were you looking to come in?
Yeah, I think the sort of social care has sort of rightly been sort of highlighted as part of this. It's in particular self-directed support is an example of where some of the, I suppose the sort of the implementation gap between policy and the sort of reality. Sort of our sort of research has suggested that that people's experiences of sort of self-directed support on the ground don't match up to what should be in legislation, and finance and the budget has a huge part to play in that. I think sort of at the kind of human rights budgeting for me gives a framework to make some of these decisions and to identify what isn't being met, what is required to meet the minimum core and achieve it. It was sort of pointed out sort of I think the sort of the earlier panel that the sort of the estimates from the independent review of adult social care was that the sort of additional expenditure of around £660 million per year on social care was required to sort of meet its recommendations, which would be about sort of 0.4% of Scottish GDP. But it was pointed out in the earlier panel than there's sort of other countries where there's sort of far more sort of spent on these areas.
Okay, thank you. Hayley?
Thank you. I think when it comes to defining the content of individual rights and looking for that minimum core, obviously we have frameworks like the AAAQ, and we have general recommendations and general comments from international committees that we can look to as a starting point when it comes to each sort of human right that might be relevant in an issue like social care, which will not just be one right. I think, however, when it comes to, well, as part of defining that content, we need to have a really good eye for what that means for different groups and go beyond a kind of formal non-discrimination approach. And actually, CEDAW and other conventions talk about this principle of substantive equality and what it actually will take for women and other groups to have a material improvement in their conditions. So I think one of the key issues will be capacity and the skill and expertise that will be needed to sort of build a general awareness of what the content of human rights means and is and looks like across not only public bodies but civil society as well, to really engage in that. So I think there's a capacity question. I think there's also a prioritisation question that's relevant perhaps to what you're asking, Pam, is what we saw during the pandemic was you can't talk about the minimum core of a human right and not talk about principles like non-retrogression and non-derogation. And we saw retrogression in women's rights. We saw social care packages cut and removed. And we saw schools closed and women not being able to undertake paid work and having to give up paid work entirely. So we did see a rollback in women's rights. I don't really know how to answer that problem, but I think it prioritisation is going to have to come into it, and we need to have an agenda that's funded to avoid some of the decisions that were made in the context where we have mainstreaming obligations, which are meant to avoid these things happening. We're supposed to have impact assessments that mean that we don't unwittingly further embed inequality, and it just didn't happen.
Okay, if we could go to Alexander now.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, second panel. I'm going to stick to what I asked the first panel, which was very much about the participation, the engagement. And it would be very useful to hear from all of you about what degree of engagement and participation you have experienced for your organisation and for those that you represent. And has there been a good exchange with the Scottish Government about what their intentions are and the attempts that they'd have to progress things? We've talked about barriers already today in the sector. So have you experienced barriers within your own organisation? Do your client base and your service users experience that? It'd be good to get a flavour of what you believe and what you think can be done to improve that transparency and the scrutiny that we're taking place when we're looking at this whole budget process. Thank you.
Jatin, do you want
to? I mean, for my organisation, Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights, we don't have service users as such. We're more of a strategic organisation. But even then, I found it quite difficult to get my head around a lot of these things. It's the first time we've really had a discussion about budgeting with this committee. So, you know, not don't want to stereotype anything, but if we found it difficult, I can imagine, and it takes time as well. Luckily, you know, we have time to invest in this. Other groups that have service users don't have the time to. I mean, even reading some of the SPICE reports and things takes hours sometimes. So I don't think, I don't think people are really interested in the overall budget as such. They're interested in the outcomes for their own lives. And back to, you know, again, personally, I have no interest in the fisheries budget whatsoever. So that's just a silly example. I think it's going back to outcomes. I think that's what people will be interested in. And even, I was going to say this in the opening statement, but I didn't get to it. We're not really good at evaluating what the money is spent on just now. And I think people will be far more invested in getting involved in that. And that might be a better way to involve them. The other thing somebody on the earlier panel said of just looking at one particular aspect, I think that would be another good option, because that's, again, back to what people's interests are. They're interested in things that have impact on their own lives, and that's a good starting point. So that's the way to get them invested, I would say.
Okay, thank you. Do you have anybody online? Rob, thank you. Sorry. Rob, were you trying to get in there?
I think there's see sort of participation is a sort of key human rights principle, but sort of there's sort of raised concerns about the level of public participation in the budget process, and that as we heard earlier on, the sort of Scottish Human Rights Commission has published research that shows that Scotland falls below the sort of globally recommended standards in relation to sort of public participation in the budget process. Sort of ourselves as a sort of an organisation, a national third sector intermediary, we have sort of members who have plenty of lived experience and professionals, including those who are focused on sort of economy related activity. We've sort of participated in the sort of engagement sessions by the sort of National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership, as well as sort of holding our own events. But I think there's a lot more that can and should be done to improve participation. And I think that probably would need to be sort of built into the budget process in terms of the sort of the timescales for to allow sort of meaningful participation sort of before the sort of the budget's published, and to sort of really that has a sort of genuine impact on the budget that the sort of the engagement and the participation activity is linked to the sort of the decisions and the that are made as part of the as part of the budget process.
Thanks, Rob. Adam?
Thanks for the question. Actually, it's not easy at all. And I don't think anyone in the original panel said it would be the case. And I think if you look at the time frame that's involved in such a thing, it's incredibly short. And if you look at this budget, we're now looking at a sort of government or governing parties' commitments in their manifestos from election through to programmes for government, through to, you know, considering how to do the budget, draft budgets, you know, going through this whole process. And actually the opportunity in that kind of a bigger sense is pretty hard to influence at a time. We've got good relationships and ways in with the Minister for Equality and Older People and across government, but actually looking at the budget as a whole, actually from Age Scotland's point of view, we might over the course of a year or two or more talk about bigger themes. You know, whether it is more investment is required in social care and what the outcomes that we require as a result of that, what will have to happen so people can have better equitable access, that staff can have better paying conditions, unpaid carers are better supported, all of these types of things. And sometimes the question will come back, well, what will that cost exactly? Look, it's a really difficult question. And actually, do you come back with the bare minimum that's required? You know, talk about earlier on, but whether it's 600 odd million pounds extra required for social care, actually, why wouldn't that be a billion? To be more than it's expected. So for a charity like Age Scotland, we're looking at the information and the challenges that come in and try and look at that very long-term effort. Now, I've been at Age Scotland for 3.5 years, and I think in all of that time, we've been talking about more, and before that, more investment, social care, what is required. And then seeing that realised won't be as a result of 1 week's bit of work, it'll be over the course of many, many years. There'll be other organisations, other issues, other charities that will have maybe a better way in and that might meet government priorities at the time. But, you know, we can certainly look to influence initiatives around things, but on the broader budget, on the broader departmental spending, I think it's very hard. And for individuals, even harder still. You know, trying to navigate a budget document when it comes out, you know, how much screen time have you got? How many bits of paper you have to print off? You'd hope not to, but you might need to. But for an individual who isn't online, who's maybe in some community somewhere, might have disabilities, might have language barriers, you know, are not connected. They might have great ideas, maybe big and helpful ways to do things, but are just so disengaged by virtue of the entity that it is.
Brilliant. Going to bring Karen Adam in now.
Thank you. It's nice to see you all today. I'd like to ask a question really in regards to gendered budgeting. And, you know, providing that gender equality within services is often seen as an additional cost. It's something additional within social security, within health, women's refuge services. They're not really built around the needs of women. So the resources for gender equality is often seen as an extra, almost like an extension on policy, rather than part of the foundation of which policy is built. And we can see this clearly highlighted to us, as you alluded to earlier, you know, the disproportional impact that the pandemic has had on women. I think that was really clear to us through that time. So where do you see there is progress being made, and what is still missing in regards to this gendered budgeting? And just to add on to that, sorry to ask extra, what lessons do you think we can learn from this gendered budgeting in regards to our human rights budgeting? Is there lessons to be learned there?
Okay, Ellie, we'll start with you, I think.
I can probably answer both questions by saying I think the big lesson for me is that there is a huge gap between rhetoric and national commitment and national ambition. I think there was a joint understanding of things like a few years ago, the First Minister began talking about childcare as infrastructure, which is something women's organisations have been talking about for decades. And we now understand the pivotal role that childcare and social care play in allowing women to stay in paid work, to progress in paid work, and take on more paid work and also have better leisure and well-being activities that then mean that their general health is better, so you have a cost saving there. So we see that there are headline kind of ambitions around gender equality. The lesson is maybe that the processes and the data that we have to actually measure the success or how we're progressing towards those ambitions is missing. And I think human rights budgeting processes need to avoid that. I think that also plays into what I was saying in the opening statement I made about we need to find, and I don't have the answers for this in a neat package, but a way to integrate these two different analyses. One is very person-centred and at core, you know, focused on individual needs, and that's really important. But there is also a kind of structural component, and women and other groups will face structural barriers that other groups will not. So we need to find a way of looking at kind of individual ways of doing things or individual considerations and applying that structural lens to remove some of those barriers so that we see equality within our human rights approach. You're right that gender equality is sometimes seen as a cost. I think we have enough data now, even patchy although it is, to show that when we invest in social care, for example, we create jobs. And I do refer, I think, to the Women Budget Group's recent report on care, on the care economy, which found that the same investment in social care and in construction would create more jobs, and they would largely be women's jobs at national level. So I think we do see gender equality saves money. It doesn't can always cost money. But I also wanted to just comment, I think the last thing I would say there is that we do sometimes see a bit of a national and local disconnect. So at national level, we have these big commitments. We have a big ambition about where we want to go. But the funding for local services, the funding for local authorities to then deliver to those local services doesn't necessarily match up.
Okay. Jatin or Adam, do you want to come in just now? Or?
Well, just briefly, I agree with what Ailey's saying there. I mean, in terms of what I said earlier about, you know, certainly from a race point, but probably from a lot of other characteristics, about eliminating discrimination, we need to make that cost more. If people discriminate, it needs to cost them. And we're not really good at that, because we're not really good at challenging discrimination when it's happening. And if, from a budgeting point of view, we're not really good at supporting advocacy to support people's rights to equality and human rights, so that there's another angle there of no point talking about human rights if you can't insist on them applying to you.
So. Okay, thank you. So I'm going to take Maggie and then Pam Gossel.
Thanks very much, Joe. Thank you to the panel for joining us today and for your contributions so far. I suppose extending a little bit of some of what was underlying in Karen's question, I'm interested in, and you've all picked up in different ways on how we look at different rights as they apply to or should apply to different groups. Given we know we lack some of the data we need, and we know we lack maybe common understanding, how can we, as we develop this work, because we are only starting this, how can we over the next few years, as we see in the incorporation of other human rights obligations, the other international conventions and treaties that it is our desire to incorporate into Scots law, how can we use those as ways to give us better frameworks or better tools for analysis and for delivery, because I understand there's that mismatch, as you've all said, in different ways around rhetoric and ambition and implementation. So what does the incorporation of additional human rights frameworks allow us to do and allow us to do differently?
Okay, who would like to come in?
Sorry. <Ellie? laughs>
Thank you. It's a really good and complicated question. I think some of what I said previously about we're going to just need to accept that there's going to need to be some capacity building that needs to be done around understanding what the human rights frameworks mean. We will have access to kind of the international jurisprudence, but also we can learn from other countries around how they've interpreted the different rights. And a lot of that will depend on what incorporation looks like in the bill, the extent to which it's a direct and full incorporation from the international source. So I think some of those things, like the general recommendations, I mean, no one has read every single general comment or general recommendation, certainly that I've ever met, but we will probably find a lot of answers in some of the ways in which other people have thought about these questions. There's general recommendations from ICESCR which talk about human rights budgeting, or at least elements of human rights budgeting. But hopefully we can take different bits from different treaties, I think, is going to have to be the big answer to that.
Okay, we'll hear from Rob and then we'll hear from Pam. Rob.
Thank you. I suppose given that Scotland is planning to incorporate international human rights into domestic law, it's in many ways it's an ideal time for the Scottish Government to applying a human rights based approach to the budgetary decisions and processes. I think in particular, one of the core standards is sort of maximum available resources. So for instance, that would require the sort of Scottish Government to raise as much income as it can for the national budget and prioritise the effective realisation of economic, social and cultural rights, as well as sort of ensuring that sort of all budgets allocated to rights are spent and sort of not wasted. I think there's kind of a sort of golden opportunity there. I think I would sort of certainly sort of agree with sort of Ailey Dixon's points and the points made earlier that there is a sort of a lack of sort of knowledge and understanding around sort of human rights and how it can be sort of practically used. One of the sort of the hopes is that as part of incorporating sort of human rights instruments into Scots law, that's used as a stimulus to increase sort of understanding and awareness, and that would be sort of one of the sort of key advantages of sort of incorporating human rights instruments into law is that it leads to that greater understanding and has an impact on things like the national budget.
Thank you. Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome, panel. We've all heard about how the pandemic has had a devastating impact on gender equality, and it's been stated that it would set women back decades. So today I'd like to ask the question around the risk that women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work might get worse and then reduce their ability to find paid work and income. So firstly, are we looking at a prospect of two-tier workplace where men go back and yet women stay home? Secondly, according to a survey for the BBC released this morning, just over half, 56% women said they thought working from home would help them progress at work. As childcare and caring duties become less of a hindrance to working full-time, so do you think a shift to flexible work patterns would create a more equal playing field for some women?
Okay, thank you. Who wants to... Adam?
Thank you. You're right to say, and everyone else right to say, that women have been extraordinarily impacted and disproportionately impacted by this impact for their own lives, for their care responsibilities, for their work opportunities, chances, and having to readdress. I was sort of reflecting on my own position of going to the pandemic, and we were expecting a baby, had a baby last July, and able to work from home. I'd actually been around present more, whereas a kind of a culture, which wasn't necessarily just that was a thing at Age Scotland, very much embraced flexible working, might have not allowed me to be around every single day. But just seeing the kind of the challenges that people will face to kind of meet the childcare responsibilities, meet the caring responsibilities at different age spectrums, and Ailey talked earlier on, I think it was about in social care, and women then having to pick up all of these responsibilities. You know, the pandemic really has had a big impact, and we're not through it yet. And I think there's a huge amount of culture change required in the workplace. And I think there is still, in lots of employers, that urge and demand to get people back to the office in some way. But it doesn't have to be. If they've been able to kind of fulfil what they do externally, what is that? Why is that there? Some people might want to go back at times. But at the same point, this is really my point about the kind of childcare element, not talking about a man's point of view, I didn't mean to do that. But it was, you know, the challenges faced in terms of getting childcare to go back to work in the first year, hugely expensive. I mean, it is. It's hugely expensive. I know there are commitments made in year two and year three before to bring that down. But that first year, you know, kind of going back to work, if you've had a child or haven't, is very, very difficult indeed, unless you have a support network in place, unless you're pretty well paid, you know, all of these types of things. But on the care itself and the role it's had and the more and more unpaid carers who have had to then step away because of the removal and reduction of social care packages has been wild. You know, I had people about last March 2020 whose social care packages were turned off overnight. You know, we then saw a knock-on impact in the excess death levels of people living with dementia. You know, pretty sure the two are linked, because the social care package is at home, but people are having to step in and do a huge amount of work, which they might not be as able or feel as able to do as they possibly can, but their commitment to do it is huge. And, you know, this will be something which we'll be living now with for many, many years. But making sure that can public services support people to either go back into work, can the Scottish Government influence employers in the workplace to have better and more flexible arrangements. I think this is part of it. Having a, you know, we work on age-inclusive workplaces to really look at the flexibilities required, caring responsibilities everywhere for career progression, to make sure you're not kind of left out of work by not being present and the presenteeism that's required. So I think there's going to be huge, huge challenges ahead. And I think leadership will be required in terms of showing the best practice, showing what people want and supporting them to do what they need to maybe fulfill their job, but also for the rest of their life as well.
Okay, thanks, Adam. I'm going to go to Fulton McGregor, who wants to come in on this question first before we go to the other panellists.
Thanks, convener. I appreciate you bringing me in. I feel almost a moral duty to come in at this point because, as many members will be aware, but not perhaps panellists, I'm actually coming in remotely today, which was primarily to allow me to help with childcare issues this morning after our original plans fell through. And had I not been able to do this, which would have been the case prior to the pandemic, the care of three young children, one at school, one at nursery, and one a 9-week-old baby, would have fallen to my partner, a woman. And before the pandemic, we would have just got on with it. We'd have known that that was wrong, but we'd have just got on with it. And, you know, it struck me last night when I was chatting with the convener, who I have to say has been absolutely excellent. We were chatting with him over text. It struck me that that's absolutely unacceptable. And the pandemic should have taught us all that. Now, I'm fortunate enough to work in, you know, the Scottish Parliament, which is democratic, modern, you know, that sort of thing. But there'll be a lot of other situations out there where that's not the case. So I suppose my question, I felt a duty to come in on that, given my situation relates directly to that today and how it's highlighted it to me. I wonder maybe if Ailey could comment how we can make sure that, or any of the panellists, how we can make sure that that notion that it's, that, you know, it's unacceptable that this childcare responsibility just naturally falls back to the woman is now no longer acceptable because of the pandemic, and all workplaces, you know, need to respond to that. And I wonder, Ailey, perhaps you might be best placed to comment on that. I know came to that question eventually there.
Thanks, Fulton. I think that kind of follows on actually from some of the points you made earlier on, Ailey, about, you know, when schools are closed, that's generally women that are impacted, and Pam's point about flexibility, you know, can we lock some of that in?
Yeah, there's so much I could say here, and apologies if this is a little bit of a scattergun thought dump. But last year, Engender published a report looking at the effects of unpaid care. We defined that quite broadly, so the sort of women's unpaid work the effect of the pandemic on women's unpaid work. And what we found was that women and men, all of the studies at that point, we were sort of halfway through the first lockdown, all of the studies that were coming out were showing that, yes, mums and dads were doing more childcare. That was inevitable. Schools were closed, and that was across lots of different countries when we looked at the time use data. But inevitably, mothers were doing more. Even when both parents were at home, mothers were interrupted more. And when we had an economist do some light calculations for us, and we estimated that the cost of the women's inability to continue with unpaid work, whether that was because they couldn't go into the office or because they were being interrupted or because it was just impossible to combine the kind of homeschooling expectations with the paid work that they could do at home, that amounted to £15 million a day in Scotland. So I suppose that comes back to Karen's earlier question about the costs of not intervening sometimes are enormous. Obviously, that was during the first lockdown when we had the greatest restrictions. But even as we moved through the pandemic and schools reopened, we still saw that the contingency planning assumed that at a moment's notice, one of the parents could take time off work to pick up a child who had been a close contact of somebody else. And that, to some extent, has continued for over a year now, and to some extent still does. The question about a two-tiered workplace, I think, if I understand you correctly, I think you're entirely right to be concerned about it, and we are concerned about it too. The sectors that have been most disrupted by the pandemic are those where women, particularly young women and women of colour, see their employment concentrated, and because young women are more likely to kind of have small children, again, they're doubly impacted by school closures and other measures. So the sectors that have seen the most disruption are those that employ women. Women have been more likely to be furloughed unless they've asked to be furloughed, in which case men who have asked to be furloughed for childcare reasons have been more likely to receive furlough than women have. So there's a lot one could say. I highly recommend Close the Gaps report, Disproportionate Disruption, which does look in more detail at some of the specific sectors that have been affected by the pandemic. I also think it's now time we have to get serious about childcare, and we've seen commitments most recently in the manifestos, but in the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls reports that the Scottish Government has responded to, calling for 50 hours a week of wraparound, flexible, fully funded and culturally competent childcare. We have to kind of expand the rollout and of free childcare, and the pause to the 1140 hours was during a time of significant crisis for women's unpaid work did not help matters in any way. So there's a lot more I could say, and I'm happy to come back in if there's anything else that you would like specifically to comment on, but I will leave it there otherwise.
Okay, thanks for that. And Pam Duncan-Glancy wants to come in now.
Thank you, Convener, for allowing this. I felt also that while we were having that discussion, I think it's the other aspect that women, I think, have ended up having to pick up is unpaid care. So, for example, all through the pandemic, a lot of people lost the social care that they absolutely relied on, and it was assumed that somebody would just step in and do it. And we've heard in other committees and in Parliament and also in all of our own engagement, I'm sure, that carers in the last year have been literally working their fingernails to the bone without a break. And a lot of them will be women. Is there anything that we can do or that we can suggest through our committee in the budget that could begin to redress that? And the £15 million a day figure is staggering. And I'm assuming that includes having to stop and pick up unpaid care as well as childcare. If it doesn't, then it's going to be more. So, it'd be really, really interested to hear if you can think of any ways that we can begin to try and redress that balance and, in particular, stop the regression of women's rights that we've seen and heard about today.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, you're absolutely right, and there's nothing I would disagree with in that. We, as we're talking about expanding provision of childcare, we need to expand the provision of social care, and that means different types of social care, including respite care for unpaid carers. So that would be one thing. We've also had quite a significant delay to the rollout of carers' assistance, or the Scottish Carers' Assistance, and the development of that. So I think that might be an opportunity to start thinking, can we do more? Can we expand eligibility? Can we increase the kind of seriously insufficient rate of carers allowance in this country that plunges? I mean, women provide more unpaid care than men, but of the unpaid carers that are women, they tend to be the ones who are reliant on carers allowance and who are surviving on poverty wages where they are working. I would maybe ask the committee to take a look last year alongside the paper on unpaid care that we produced in conjunction with Close the Gap and supported by other women's organisations and gender, produced 9 principles for an economic recovery. And if we're going to talk about an economic recovery that centres women, I think some of those principles might be a useful place to start. And they do talk about unpaid care. They do talk about investing in local communities where women are more likely to spend their paycheck. So I would highly recommend that paper be somewhere that you start.
OK, thanks. I'm just going to ask Adam to come in.
It was just very quickly. I thought it was an excellent question, and Ailey's answered a lot of kind of what I was going to say. But there was two extra parts that I thought was, in terms of certainly budgeting, was that big long-term approach to what we require to build massive resilience. The impact of COVID-19 is about zero resilience in the social care sector, notwithstanding the hardest work possible that people working in social care were doing. If they're getting ill with COVID or had to isolate and all decisions, they couldn't undertake their work, but there was no one to pick up the slack. We're seeing NHS boards declaring essentially states of emergency in Scotland where they can't, particularly Lanarkshire, I think it was one of the first ones, where they couldn't deliver as much social care as they'd planned, and also either hospital admission or access to GPs because there wasn't enough resilience in it. The point about the money and a bigger spend is building this for the future. So if you double the social care budget today, you won't have enough people tomorrow to kind of fill that. It will be years to get that, so it will require that long-term investment. And with regard to women and unpaid care, one of the big problems we're not looking at again in the future is the massive gap in pension wealth and living better in later life. Currently, I think, as I recall, the gap between men and women is 10 times in terms of pension wealth. Now, of all that unpaid care, unplanned unpaid care, less pension contribution, less NI kind of contribution, that people, when they have to retire or have to retire early and draw down pension pots before they need to and before they should, they'll find themselves living longer on less income and equally then in poorer health. So we're going to have big impact on the Scottish budget as a result of not kind of fixing this. So it's quite a complex matter, but we have a real concern in Scotland about this pension wealth gap between men and women, and actually the unpaid care is a real big part of this, which we'll see the challenge in many decades to come. But the start of it was sort of now, or has been now for a few years.
Okay, thanks very much. Rob?
Yes, just briefly, and there's sort of not a sort of great deal I would add to Ailey's points, but just to sort of briefly emphasise that sort of unpaid carers should be a priority. And I think we've sort of seen the impact of the pandemic on unpaid carers has been stark. There's sort of research from the Carers Trust that's illustrated that a sort of wide range of sort of areas that that unpaid carers have been particularly affected. I think the particular one that prioritises is around respite, and that sort of a large number of unpaid carers sort of haven't had a sort of break from caring for over a year. Sort of some of them have reported that that since the pandemic began, they haven't had a break from caring. So I think that would be yes, sort of to unpaid carers being a priority as part of the budget process. And I think particularly around breaks and respite would be key.
Okay. Palmer, you want to come back in? Okay, unless anyone's got any burning questions, I think we're going to wrap the session up there. There's lots more questions we would have for you. And again, you've got us thinking about lots of other things. So thank you all very much. It's been a really, really useful session. The committee will now move into private session. Thank you.